Now we are starting the budget. The changes which has been recommended in the budget 2021. Sir, first, these are the list of the changes in the CGST Act. Also, there was only one changes in the IGST Act, that is Section 16. Supply. New clause has been inserted. New clause has been inserted in the supply. We all know that supply has been defined in Section 7 of the CGST Act. Earlier, there were four clauses: Section 7, Subsection 1, Clause A, Clause B, Clause C, and Clause D. From 1st Feb 2019, when GST Amendment Act 2018 was introduced, was made effective, then Clause D has been retrospectively deleted. What was the impact of that deletion? Impact of that deletion was that Schedule 2 will no more considered to be the deemed supply. New subsection has been inserted. Section 7, subsection 1A, which gives the or which define the scope of the Schedule 2, any activity or the transaction which is supply as per 7.1, then whether this activity or the transaction will be treated as a supply of the goods or supply of services, meaning thereby the scope of the Schedule 2, which was earlier as a deemed supply, because of this retrospective changes on 1st Feb 2019, has limited to only categorization between goods or services. Moving first, that there was one para 7. I'm talking about para 7. So para 7 was talking about or giving the effect that supply of the goods by unincorporated association. Supply of the goods by unincorporated association or body of the person to the member for cash, deferred payment, or any other valuable consideration will be treated as a supply of the goods. It was in support of the Article 366, Clause 29A, Subclause E, which was inserted on 46th Amendment to the Indian Constitution. It acts on supply of the goods by unincorporated association to the member will be a supply. When this clause was deleted, when the Schedule 2 was delinked, when the Schedule 2 was delinked from the 7.1 supply definition, it means now the Schedule 2 cannot decide whether my transaction is supply or not. The recent judgment of the Apex Court in Calcutta Club has given that even in the club and transaction between club and member are not taxable even after insertion of this clause in the Indian Constitution based on the doctrine of the mutuality, because club and member are not two different person, and one person cannot make the supply to himself. So the apex court is saying that considering the doctrine of the mutuality, still the transaction is not taxable. To make the transaction taxable between the club and member, this amendment, and that to be retrospective amendment, was inserted in 7.1 supply definition. What was the amendment? Let's read it together. The activity of the transaction by a person other than individual. Please note, earlier it was talking about unincorporated association. To remove the ambiguity, incorporated or corporated, they have used the word other than individual. The all the changes in the language was made in order to set aside the order of the apex court. Whatever the language they have used in the decision, they have tried to remove the ambiguity. They have used the word other than individuals instead of unincorporated association. To its member, earlier it was limited to its member. They have widened the scope. Member or constituent or vice versa. It means now the arrow would not be like this, club to member. Even this relation can also be, this relation can also be taxable and considered as a supply. Explanation for the purpose of this clause. And one more thing, they are saying for cash, for deferred payment or other valuable consideration. It means the business condition not required to be satisfied. There is no element that it is should be in the course or furtherance of the business. The explanation says that for the purpose of this clause, it is hereby clarified that notwithstanding anything contained in any other law, probably they are referring the Income Tax Act, wherein still the doctrine of the mutuality principle is exist. Any judgment, they are referring Calcutta Club, various judgment are there, decree or order of any court, tribunals or authority, and its member constituents shall be deemed to be the two separate person, and the supply shall be deemed to have taken place from one person to another person. So the law, the intention is very, very clear. They like to text the transaction between club and member in the GST, and that to be the retrospective effect. This does not give the clarity. Rather, I should say, this will create the again too much litigation. Well, this dimming fiction can create the transaction taxable in the GST. Yet to wait. So this is the first amendment. Now I am coming to the second amendment, and we all know this second amendment, which is related to input tax credit, is again important. A new clause has been inserted. What is the 16th subsection 2? It talks about the four condition. 16th subsection 2 talks about the four condition for taking the input tax credit. The first condition, the clause A, you should have the tax invoice. Clause B, goods or service has been received. Clause C, tax has been paid by the supplier. and clause D, recipient has filed the GSTR 3B. These are the four conditions. And parallelly, the rule 36 was there, and I like to discuss only sub rule 4. May I request to all the participants, can you tell me the 36 rule was inserted by which date? Rule 36 sub rule 4 kab insert hua tha? Now you can reply. Yes, the rule 36-4 was inserted on 9th of October 2019. It was creating the condition that you can take the ITC which is appearing in your statement, plus if it is not appearing, then additional 20%. 1st Jan 2020, this 20% has been reduced to 10%. 1st Jan 2021, this percentage has been reduced to 5%. Now the important question, that, and we also know that rule 36-4 has been challenged in multiple court. Writ petition has been accepted, and it has been challenged in multiple court, like Rajasthan court. And the notice has been issued. Now this amendment has been inserted. Can we say to give the legal backing to 36-4? Prima facie you can say, but I should say even beyond that. The date when it is notified, then 36-4 has not any relevance. Why I am saying so? The reason that you can take the ITC of invoice or debit note, which has been referred in the clause A, which has been furnished by the supplier in the statement of outward supply, that is under section 37. GSTR 1, and such details has been communicated to the recipient of such invoice or the debit note. The details to be communicated to the recipient, then only that ITC can be availed. There is no power. It is not being written that, or if there is a missing ITC or if it is not appearing, as prescribed, you can take additional ITC, meaning thereby the day when it is effective notified, 36-4 has no relevance, and after that we can't take ITC additionally. Whatever appearing in my statement, that much ITC I need to take. Next part, whether GSTR 2A or the GSTR 2B. They are talking about simply in the statement of the outward supply, and such details have been communicated to the recipient, whether it is 2B or is it 2A. What do you think? Is it 2B or 2A? Great. It is now 2B. Some counter argument. Sometime I heard that, sir, rule 36-4 was talking about 2A. Sir, no. It is again not talking any 2A or 2B. But, sir, circular 123 is there, issued in November 2019. That is talking about 2A. I do agree that there is a question number 3 in which there is a reference of the 2A. But we all know that in that reference also, they are saying 2A of which date? 2A of which date? Sir, due date of GSTR1. Due date of GSTR1. And because 2A is the dynamic document, updated on every times. Therefore, there was a requirement to have one static document not going to be updated after the due date. Therefore, we can say even circular 123 is somehow talking about 2B. But because 2B was not there at that point of time, so the reference was made on 2A. But again, they were saying it should be taken having on the due date of the GSTR1. Great. Nothing to say too much about this, but we all know now the GST audit is no more. 1920, they have clarified and we are doing the audit, but it will not be there from 2021 or 21-22. That will be clarified. But again, we can say it is for the finance budget 2021, which normally be effective on 1 April 2021. So we can say that we might have to do the GST audit for 2021, but the chances are very lesser. But still, believe me, friends, deletion of 35(5) also are not going to reduce the work of any professional. Because if I'm saying we professional are working as a bridge between the SSE and government, we all know that by vouching the entire in the GST audit, by vouching the data, we are trying to find out the mistake that taxpayer has committed and try to settle maximum with the interest liability of that period, the day when we are signing the audit. So at least we can say we have saved the interest, which may extend to 5 years, which may be liable to the penalize. Again, their department audit 65 or 66. And last annual return, which has been added the word self-certified reconciliation statement. Still, I'm saying if you analyze with your existing client, I can say 60 to 70% will still be continue to take your professional advice, because independently, they are not very much confident whether they are able to do the reconciliation or not. I do agree that there would be some loss. There would be some loss, but it is a timing difference which will be compensated in future in terms of the additional work of the litigation. That much I like to say. Amendment to the section 50. The section 50 is talking about interest. It was clarified also with various communication press release. In the last amendment, it was made retrospectively. No, it was made prospectively, but we have received the confirmation press release wherein the government was saying that we will make certain changes to make it retrospectively. And finally, this was a good, we can say the good amendment which made retrospectively. What is that? Interest on net tax liability. Suppose you have the tax liability of 100 rupees and you have the ITC of 70 rupees. You are paying the tax in cash of rupees 30. Then interest would be payable on 30 rupees. What is the proviso? Let's read together. Provided that interest on the tax payable, interest on tax payable in respect of the supplies made during a tax period. So for example, I'm talking about 100 rupees was pertaining to say October 20 and declared in the return for the said period. It means I have reported the same in October 20 GST returns. So I can say that it has been reported in GSTR 3B in the October 20 and furnished after the due date, assuming we are in Delhi, because we are in Delhi, assuming the date is 24th, I have opted monthly and actually return is being furnished on 30th. So there was a delay of 6 days. Interest would be payable on rupees 30. I have the 100 tax liability, 70 ITC balance amount, which I need to pay in cash. There may be the possibility that you have reported 90 in the October 20. And the balance, say suppose, changing the example, you have the tax liability of only 50 rupees. You have the ITC of 70. There is no amount to be paid in cash. So therefore we can say there has to be no interest. Fully agree. But assume that in October GSTR 3B, you have reported 40 because of any reason. Now the balance 10 you have reported in November. Question was whether interest need to be paid even though I have the sufficient ITC or interest not required to be made because of this proviso. I need your view. Repeating the example again, there was 50 rupees my tax liability. I have the ITC of 70. In the GSTR 3B, I have reported rupees 40 in the month of October. The balance amount which is missed, I have added in the next month. Do I need to pay the interest even though there is a sufficient balance? Answer would be yes. Reason, declared in the return for the said period. It means the liability pertaining to October, and if you reported in October, then you are not required to pay to the extent of ITC. You are not required to pay interest to the extent of ITC. If you added the same in the subsequent GST returns, you cannot avail the benefit of this proviso. So that was changes, we all know. Next point, I was only saying that interest will be on net tax liability, which is paid in cash, provided you have reported the full tax liability in the same month. Certain portion of the tax liability which you missed in the current month, you have added in the next month. Probably you will not be get any relief because of this proviso. Interest would be leviable. 74. They have delinked the section 129 and 130. Main reason, we all know that when we are paying the tax, interest, penalty under section 74, the proceeding, all the person liable to pay the penalty, 122, 125, 129, 130, deemed to be concluded. It means if I have been assessed under section 74 and I have paid, communicated to the department, all the proceeding will be deemed to be concluded. Deleted means now they like to proceed the action of section 129, 130 separately. Even the proceeding has been concluded in section 74, the separate initiation can be continued. Section 75, general provision relating to the determination of the tax. The section 75 was saying that whatever the tax liability is there, which is self-assessed tax reported in section 39, can be recovered by using the provision of section 79 without any so-called notice. Meaning thereby, if there is a self-assessed tax liability under section 39 and which is not paid, it can be recovered without SCL. But the problem is the GSTN portal does not allow, if I have reported something in GSTR3B, if I have reported in 3B, it cannot be possible that I can keep the pending. Without paying the amount in GSTR3B, I can't file 3B, sir. That is the problem. So even they are saying section 39, but it does not have any relevance. Now, what is the changes? The changes is if amount which you have reported in GSTR1, amount which you have reported in GSTR1 and the tax which you are paying in section 39 GSTR3B is lesser, GSTR1 tax liability is higher and 3B tax liability is lower, then it will be considered as self-assessed tax. It is considered as self-assessed tax. It means now the department can recover the amount. Without so-called notice. We all know that some practice is being going on in the market that they are reporting in the GSTR1. So it will appear in the recipient. They will make the payment, but at the same time, supplier not ready to pay the tax. So he is reporting lesser amount in 3B. We all know the recent changes in section 29. The registration cancellation, the provision has been amended and the same point has been added that if there is a difference in the tax liability, department may cancel the registration. One judgment of Kabir Realty Private Limited, Honorable Madhya Pradesh High Court, held that action of the department initiating the recovery without 7374 is correct. In the same case, the liability has been reported in the GSTR1 but not paid in 3B. SSE had challenged that without so-called notice, department cannot make the recovery. But in this judgment, the High Court has held that yes, that they have upheld the decision of the department. So keeping in the same line, now the recovery is comparatively valid. Exactly valid. Going to the section 83, provisional attachment to protect the revenue in certain cases. Provisional attachment to protect the revenue in certain cases, including bank account. 83 was using certain sections. Section 83 was using that if there is any pendency of any proceeding, there is any pendency either in 62, 63, 64, 73 or 74. You can see what was the 62, 63, 64, 73, 74. And in that case, department can provisionally attach property including bank account belonging to the taxable person. So the two major change, one is a scope has been widened. Second, property can attach only of the taxable person, again they have added certain more. What was the changes in the section 83? That instead of these section, five section, they have included the three chapters. They have included the three chapter. It means if the proceeding has been initiated, after the initiation of the proceeding under chapter 12, 14 and 15. 13, which is talking about the audit, is not covered in section 83. Apart from chapter 13, chapter 12, chapter 14, chapter 15, if the proceeding is pending, it has been initiated, and it is the opinion that to protect the interest of the government revenue, it is necessary to do so, he may by order in writing attach provisionally any property including bank account. Now, earlier they were talking about only for the taxable person. Now they have added that not only the taxable person, even department can attach the property of the person which has been referred in section 122, subsection 1A. What is that? Beneficiary. A person who retained the benefit of the transaction covered under clause 1, 2, 7 or clause 9 of subsection 1. We all know that section 122 talks about the penalty of 21 transaction, out of which if a person who is not the taxable person, but at whose instances mastermind of the transaction, mastermind of the particular fraud, that can also be covered now under 122 1A, and section 83 covered 122 1A, meaning thereby now the property or bank account can be attached of those person who are not the taxable person, who are not the registered person directly linked to that transaction, but yes, who are retaining certain benefit, now they are also on the radar. Amendment in section 107, appeal to the appellate authority. How much pre-deposit need to be made? It has been referred in section 107, subsection 6. Admitted part, full amount. Not admitted, for which there is a dispute, you like to fight against which amount, against that amount, you need to deposit 10%. Now, one extra, if you are making the appeal for section 129, detention, then you have to pay at least 25%. Yes, major amendment in section 129. The first amendment. 129, the first amendment, that there was tax, how much was the penalty? That equal to the tax, tax plus equal to the tax, that is the penalty. It means, say for example, there is a tax invoice of rupees 1 lakh and tax liability was 12,000. So at that point of time, we need to pay 12,000 tax and 12,000 penalty, total 24,000. The proper officer are also saying the same thing, and we are also doing the same thing. Most of the cases, we are taking the benefit of 12,000. In most of the cases, we are taking the benefit of the 12,000. Which component? Tax component. More or less, you are paying through normal PMT 06 challan by entering 12,000 in the tax part and 12,000 in the penalty part. Total 24,000, but 12,000 is again benefit is being taken by the taxpayer. We have to recall the section 17, subsection 5, clause I, block credit. Last clause, any tax is paid under section 74, 129, 130, ITC not allowed. So meaning thereby the particular tax which is being paid because of the 129, 130 ITC should not be allowed, but in the market we are taking the same. Second problem, that it was also discussed in various decision that can the proper officer have the right to charge the tax? He is not the assessing officer. That was also a question to remove from both angle, to remove the ambiguity of both the angle. They have deleted the taxes and instead of they are saying 200% penalty. Amount कहीं कोई problem नहीं है, जितना पहले मिलता था आज भी उतना ही मिलेगा. There is no decrease in the amount of the penalty, but yes, all the possible ambiguity has been removed. Now you can't take the benefit and nor you can challenge that yes, he is not authorized to collect the tax. Now he is not collecting the tax, he is only collecting the penalty amount. So wherever the word tax interest is being written, it has been replaced with the word penalty in the entire section. That is one change. Second, both the point I have explained. Section similarly, instead of the clause B was saying in case on payment of the applicable tax penalty equal to 50% when owner does not come forward to pay the tax. If the owner comes to pay the tax, then penalty was 100% tax, 100% penalty earlier. If the owner does not come, 50% of the value reduced by the tax amount. Now it has been replaced that 50% of the value or 200% of the tax, whichever is higher. If the owner does not come forward to pay the tax. In case of the exempted, same, so not discussing. Now we are talking about some process. 129(1)(c) upon furnishing the security equivalent to the amount payable under clause A or the clause B in such form, such manner as may be prescribed. Either I will pay or I will furnish the security as per 129(1)(c). Now we also discuss 129(2) wherein there was a requirement that we can release the goods in the same manner which is being prescribed in 67(6). It means by furnishing the bond equal to the value of the goods, and for tax and penalty, I will furnish the security. That has been deleted. Moving to the next slide, wait 1 minute. This particular provision 67(6) was talking about that goods can be released, the goods which has been seized can be released on provisional basis. It means if the goods has been seized, even without payment of the taxes, I can release on provisional basis upon execution of the bond and furnishing of security. So if you read the rule 140, bond would be equal to the value of the goods and security would be TIP, tax interest penalty. Now this particular provision has been deleted, meaning thereby now you had to pay the tax. No, you had to pay the penalty and then only you can release the goods. Or under 129(1)(c), if you furnish the only security to the amount payable, then the goods can be released. Bank guarantee. Now, proviso is saying that no such goods or conveyance shall be detained without serving an order. So the goods were in transit and the proper officer doing the inspection, he found some issue regarding the documentation or details entered on the e-way bill, and he liked to, after inspection, he liked to detain the goods. then order will be issued in MOV 06 for detention. After the detention, they will issue the order in MOV 06. And can anybody tell me what is the time limit within which amount to be paid, otherwise the goods were confiscated? Can you tell me what was the time limit, what was the time limit after issuance of the detention order within which amount has to be paid, otherwise goods will be confiscated? Is it 15 or something? Whether it was 15 days, I doubt. Time limit, yes. It was 14 days time was given. 14 days time was given. And the counting of the 14 days was from MOV 06. Counting of the 14 days was from MOV 06. Now, MOV 06 will be issued, and there are two more points has been added. That within 7 days from MOV 06, within 7 days, you will issue the SOCO's notice in MOV 7. You will issue the SOCO's notice in MOV 7. And within 7 days of the SOCO's notice, order to be issued in MOV 09. So the time limit of SOCO's notice was 7 days, and 7 days for the order. And now if the payment is not made, earlier the days were counted from MOV 06. Now the days would be counted from MOV 09. And the days was earlier 14, now it is 15. So I can say the entire process, which was earlier 14 days, now this has become 15 days, and in between 7 and 7, two more week has been added. Effectively, you have the time limit of 28 days or 29 days. Why the time limit has been increased? Reason, they have made provision very stringent. How? Let's read. No tax interest penalty. Wherever the word tax and interest is there, it has been replaced, and now only penalty is there. There was a judgment of the Gujarat High Court in case of Synergy Ferticam Private Limited that 129 and 130 mutually exclusively, and it should not be dependent. It is independent to each other. But yes, we all know that 129, 130 was linked. If within 14 days of the detention of the goods, if the penalty, tax, tip is being not paid, tax, interest and penalty, goods will be confiscated, and now it will be proceeded under section 130. There was a linking. After 129, they have started the 130. And 130, the language was notwithstanding anything contained. Now, what is the major change? The 7 plus 7 days has been added here. Instead of 14, it has become 15. And now, instead of confiscation, now the department will sell the goods. That is the harsh provision which has been added. And as a result, the additional 15 days time limit has been given. Earlier 14, now 29. Additional 15 days time limit was given because now there is no confiscation. Direct sale. In the 129, it will be directly sale. you can see the changes. Earlier it was talking about initiated in accordance with the provision of section 130. Now they have delinked section 130 and shall be liable to be sold or disposed of otherwise to recover the penalty. Yes, it was very good provisions. Earlier there was no provisions by which transporter can release his conveyance. He is carrying the goods of multiple person, but because of the default of any single person, his conveyance was there. It was not released. Now the good proviso is being there that yes, transporter either by making the payment of the penalties or 1 lakh, whichever is lower. It means we can say maximum amount he has to pay only 1 lakh. Upper limit is 1 lakh. If he is making the payment of the 1 lakh, then conveyance shall be released on the payment of this much of the amount. But only conveyance, not the goods. Not the goods. It means now the goods will be detained by the proper officer, but the conveyance can be released after making the payment. The 14 days has been replaced with 15 days that I have explained. 130, major three changes. First, earlier it was notwithstanding. Now it is not overriding provision. Now they are only saying that where any person. Where any person. Second, instead of, again, it was linked with the 129.1, but again, it has been delinked with 129.130. So now they are saying only the penalty equal to 100%. And the provision which was talking about fine in lieu of the confiscation, this has been deleted. Now these both provisions 129 130 are delinked and separately work. 151, power to call for information. Earlier it was statistics. Now the power is being widened. The first point, not only the commissioner, if any officer authorized by him order to direct any person, like for example, the proper officer or any officer authorized by commissioner has directed to any company, like let's say banking company, insurance company, financial institution, telecommunication company, ROC, registrar, to provide some information. Now the power has been widened, and instead of statistics, they have replaced the word information. Now the proper officer authorized or commissioner can call for the information. 152, they have created the bar on disclosure of the information. The information which has been received without the previous consent in writing, it will not be published. Second, and it will not be used for the purpose of any proceeding without giving the opportunity of the being heard. Next point, and one provision is being deleted, that except for the purpose of the prosecution under this act or any other act for the timing in force, no person is engaged in the collection of statistics. It has been deleted. The last amendment, that's 168, power to issue the instruction. They have deleted 151.1, and instead of 44.1, they are only using the 44.0 because of the changes. Last amendment, section 16 of the IGST Act, very good amendment or very major changes has been done. First, that zero rated supply. What is the zero rated supply? Sir, according to the section 16, the two type of the supply are zero rated: export and supply to the SEZ unit or developer. Now it is saying that the word authorized operation is being inserted. Authorized operation is being inserted. Now every supply to the SEZ unit or developer will not considered. Every supply will not considered as zero rated supply. only authorized operation, only for the authorized operation it will be considered. Next, can anybody tell me that after this amendment, can I make the zero rated supply, can I make the export on LUT? Can I make the export on LUT, or can I make the export on payment of IGST, or is there some changes? Can I make the export on payment of IGST? Can I make the export on LUT? Both are there, or some changes are there? I need your view. Both are there, or some changes is being made? All are saying both are there. No, sir. Now the option on payment of IGST is no more. Option on payment of IGST is no more. Only LUT. Only LUT. That was the major change. There was one major difference. There was one major difference when we are taking the refund. On LUT, we can take the refund of some component, and we are blocked for some component. Wherein, if I go for the on payment of IGST, I would be allowed for all the component. Can you tell me which component were missing, in which I am not entitled to take the refund under LUT? But I would be allowed to take the refund of, yes, it was capital goods, creating the problem and pain also. Why there is a difference? If I'm exporting and as per the process given in IGST Act, then why there is a difference? Either not allowed in that category, or please allow in this category also. Now they have stopped this category. Reason, because good amount of the refund has been obtained through automated route. Good amount of the refund has been obtained through automated route for those component of the ITC which was actually of fake invoice. If you see entire changes, they are like to make stringent. They like to make the provision stringent so that at least fake invoicing can be stop or reduced. Now I'm explaining entire provision. I'm explaining again. Earlier, we all know that refund, there was two clause, clause A and the clause B. Clause A was saying that if you supply without IGST, that is against LUT or the bond, you can claim the refund of accumulated ITC, wherein input is allowed, input service is allowed, but capital goods not allowed. Clause B was saying that if you supply with payment of IGST, you can claim the refund of the taxes paid. No more. This clause B has been deleted. Now, what is the revised clause? 16, I am talking about the changes in 16 subsection 3. Earlier there was two clause, now only 16.3. There is no clause. A registered person making zero rated supply shall be eligible to claim the refund of unutilized ITC on supply of the goods or services without payment of IGST under bond or LUT in accordance with the provision of section 54, subject to such condition, safeguard and procedure as may be prescribed. So now the clause B, which is talking about on payment of IGST, it is no more. They have inserted new proviso. Tell me one thing, I'm asking to all the participant. Is there any restriction on realization of foreign currency for export of the goods? Is there any restriction? See, two things. Try to understand two things. My transaction would be considered as export even though I have not received the foreign currency. Export of the goods. My transaction would continue to be treated as export of the goods whether I have received the foreign currency or not received the foreign currency or received the INR. But export of service, there is condition. My transaction would be treated as export of service only if I have received the foreign currency or in INR wherever permitted by Reserve Bank of India. But you remember, when we are going to take the refund, earlier there was no condition, but after that one rule has been inserted, which is talking about that you would receive the foreign currency within the time limit as prescribed in the FEMA, foreign exchange. But again, the question was, what is the legal backing of that rule? Again, question was, what was the legal backing of this rule? I'm talking about 96 capital B. So therefore, I can say now the provision is being inserted in the section 16 itself, which talks about that registered person making zero rated supplies, if they not realize the sales proceed, only goods. If they not realize the sales proceed, then they have to pay the refund. They have to pay the refund within 30 days. They have to pay the refund within 30 days after the expiry of the time limit, which is being prescribed in the FEMA. What is the time limit in the FEMA? Normally it is nine months. As it has been extended to 15 months due to the COVID-19. Same language was there, but that was in the rule 96 capital B to have the legal backing, to provide the legal backing. So this proviso is inserted and need to refund the amount. It means I can say for refund in case of the export of the goods, it is not mandatory for refund under the category of export of the goods. It is not mandatory that you have received the foreign currency. But yes, if you have taken the refund and the amount is not received as per the time limit, you need to deposit or you need to give back the amount to the department with interest. And you can again claim that refund. You can take back that refund when you realize the amount. 16.4, that was the last. 16.4 was inserted, giving the power to the government that in some situation, either they can notify the class of the person or they can notify the class of the goods or services. In that category, the goods can be exported on payment of the IGST and the supplier can take the refund of the taxes so paid. Earlier, when this option was available for every situation, every export, now it is limited and we need to wait for the notification. We need to wait for the notification, and the notification which will specify the categories of the person or goods or services, they are allowed to use the option on payment of IGST. From my side, this changes has been completed. I hope you enjoy the discussion. Now you can tell me any question if you have. Authorized operation means SEZ cannot purchase every goods and services which is being used for authorized operation as per their policies, as per their SEZ policies, that only permitted. Letter of authorization, exact word I don't know. What is being used in the particular documentations or in SEZ policy, but it should be as per SEZ policy. Sir, page industry ruling, your take. Ma'am, that part we will discuss separately, not exactly able to recall. Vivek Bajaj ji, you will get the PPT in your educating portal. You all have the login to the educating portal. By tomorrow, it will be uploaded. The recording of this as well as the presentation, both will be uploaded. अभी तक रिमूव नहीं किया गया, बट आने वाले टाइम पे रिमूव हो जाएगा, और एटलीस्ट क्योंकि टैक्सेस का कोई मतलब नहीं है 17.5 में, कोई यूज नहीं है, तो इट विल बी रिमूव्ड। जो सीसीआई के स्टूडेंट हैं 15th बैच एंड 14th बैच, जो ये आज की क्लास अटेंड कर रहे हैं, उनको भी रिकॉर्डिंग मिल जाएगा और उनको भी वो ये प्रेजेंटेशन मिल जाएगा। जो हमारा टेलीग्राम ग्रुप है उसमें मैं शेयर कर दूंगा, ठीक है नितिन जी। दमनदीप जी, फॉर क्यूआर कोड सर, टुडे वी ओनली डिस्कस द पॉइंट व्हिच हैज बीन अमेंडेड इन दिस प्रोविजंस, अमेंडेड इन दिस बजट, अपार्ट वी कैन डिस्कस इन द आइदर इन द ग्रुप और वी विल हैव द वन मोर वेबिनार। Yes, that is separately. We can discuss separately. You can discuss. I think there is no question at all. So thank you very much for joining this webinar. We'll meet very soon for another webinar. Thank you very much. Goodbye to all of you.